Get preaching. I can stay up here all night just listen to the ladies sing. Amen. Amen. Holy Ghost comes to church when these girls get up here and minister. Amen. Isaiah chapter 38. We turn there in the Word of God tonight. I so appreciate, your prayers. I was thinking about this tonight. Oh, can we leave the lights on? I need all the help I can. Anyway, I was pondering this on the way to church this evening. Praise God, you guys prayed me out of the hospital up to the pulpit. I'm thinking, you guys are pretty good. We do appreciate the numbers of folks that reached out to us in prayers and meals and kind of know what it feels like now. The Meals on Wheels thing kind of, you know, kind of interesting. We're getting a phone call, your dinner's at the door. And so we're like, so anyway, well, thank you so much. So as the story goes, the young motorist is going down back in the mid-1920s America. He's driving down a dirt road, which the majority of roads in America in the 20s were dirt. Car begins to sputter and falter, and suddenly it stalls and he pulls off to the side of the road. He opens up the hood, but the reality is it's all Greek to him. He's just looking at a bunch of wires and cables and pieces of metal parts. And he's kind of standing there in frustration. And after a while, another motorist coming in the opposite direction pulls off to the side. The gentleman gets out of the car and he says, "What seems to be the problem?" And he goes, "Well, it's my car. It's just stalled. It's dead. I don't know what's wrong with it." Man gets out, jumps over, walks across the street. He says, "Well, let me take a look at it." Sticks his head underneath the hood and he starts tinkering. The young man's sitting in the driver's seat and all he hears is this guy moving some things around and some squeaking and jiggling. And after a moment, he says, "Turn it over." And the young man turned the key, and the car started up. And he says, I can't believe that. What in the world? How did you do that? I've been tinkering this thing for half an hour." The man puts the hood down, wipes his hands, and he says, "I'm Henry Ford. That's my car. If anybody knows how to fix a Ford, it's going to be Henry Ford." He says, "I invented this thing." You and I are living in God's invention. Listen to me carefully. We are living in the invention called creation. That we are subject to creation. We are subject to things in the universe, and we'll get into that. But the reality, though, is creation is subject to God. So we're going to read one of the most incredible stories that I learned this as a new convert, and it just made such an impact on me that I never get tired of preaching this text. And so Isaiah chapter 38, starting with verse number 1. "And in those days Hezekiah was sick and near death. And Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amoz, went to him and he said to him," now you gotta underline this part right here, "Thus says the Lord." Okay, God is saying this. God sent me. "Set your house in order, for you shall die and not live." And Hezekiah turned his face toward the wall, and he prayed to the Lord, and he said, "Remember now, O Lord, I pray, how I have walked before you in truth and with a loyal heart, and I have done what is good in your sight." And Hezekiah wept bitterly. And the word of the Lord came to Isaiah, saying, "Go back and tell Hezekiah, thus says the Lord, the God of David your father, I heard your prayer. I have seen your tears. Surely I will add to your days 15 more years. Father, I pray right now for the anointing, God, that I help me to bring a clear trumpet sound to your people this evening. I pray, God, touch, Lord, those that are in despair tonight, those that have maybe lost hope. God, living under their circumstances, I pray, cause faith to be birthed tonight in every heart in this place, God. Make this sermon a blessing to every man and woman in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's talk first of all about our own limitations. Because we live in a very limited world. In other words, we're limited by our abilities. We have dimensions that we have to live by. I don't play basketball. I don't like basketball. I was short. I never got picked. I always sat on the bench. And so I play baseball. Okay, I'm challenged by height. I am not fast. I am not a good swimmer. I'm on and on. I live by limitations, and so does everybody else in this room. We have limitations of, say, sickness. That maybe you're here and you've lived with lifelong sickness. In the text, Hezekiah, that here he is, the sickness that he's been dealing with now for years has run its course. There's no more options. That literally, that even God has sent the prophet. How many know it's pretty bad that when God sends the prophet and you're hoping, oh, praise God, he's going to give me a word, rise up. And instead the prophet goes, no, you're dead. You didn't get your affairs in order, man. And you can talk about the woman with the issue of blood. The Bible says 12 years she suffered at the hands of the physicians. Jesus, in the course of his ministry, we have no idea how many people he prayed for, the blind, the lepers, the palsy, that here he was constantly surrounded by people with health issues, that you could be here this evening, you're saved, you love God, you're in this place tonight, but you're sitting in your chair tonight, maybe in pain, living with symptoms, living with sickness, possibly years. Hannah, the Bible says, was barren. It didn't matter how bad she wanted a baby. She's barren. It ain't happening. It could be social issues. It could be your upbringing. Today, pastoring the fatherless generation that hears people, young men who struggle with their identity and insecurity, and they wrestle with self-pity and uncontrolled emotions because they never had a father look them in the eye and go, you're not going to act like that, son. You're not going to behave like that in this house. The inability to maybe deal with people. You've heard the term, I'm sure. You've maybe even used the term, raised by wolves. I've gone home and thought to myself, I'm thinking, I think he was actually raised by wolves. I mean, no social skills. I mean, I'm talking about, I remember pastoring a young lady that I remember, I finally had to go up to her and I'm whispering in the back of her ear as discreet as I could, going, dear, you don't have to say everything that comes into your mind. I mean, she's the one that would tell you, your baby's ugly. Why's your baby funny looking? And I'm like, people that lack social skills, it could be a lack of education. You never went to school. You never completed school. It could be spiritual, and you live under family curse. Your family seems to struggle with spiritual issues. Here's Jabez, the Bible says. He's named Jabez, born in pain. Could you imagine that here, the safest place for a child should be in the warm embrace of his mother, that no deeper sense of love that a child should be able to feel than from the embrace and the love of his own mother. And yet, can you imagine his mother looking at him going, you were worth the pain to birth you. The spirit of rejection is going to kill him. illegitimacy. It's going to destroy him. You can talk about, again, insecurity, self-pity, unstable, on and on and on. It could be economic issues. That your money is limited. Your skills are limited. Like I said, your education. It seems like you struggle from year to year. There's people in this room. You've caught yourself saying this. It's not like you hate God or that you love God. You love the Lord. You're here this evening, but you've caught yourself where it's like your frustration. You just see it's like all we do is struggle. All we do is from one year to the next, go from one hardship to another. You talk about the widow of Zarephath. Her husband has died, leaving her and her son. Now there's a famine. Things go from bad to worse. They're limited resources. They're looking. They're fetching some kindling wood. They've got just enough meal to she's going to go home and make a little pita bread for her and her son. They're going to eat it, and that's it. That's all the resources that they have. And they're going to wait for starvation to take its effect. There was a woman whose husband was one of the sons of the prophets. He died, leading to debt, and the debt collectors are coming. And back then, it's not like, well, we're going to repossess the car. No, we're repossessing the kids. We're going to take the kids, and we're going to make them slaves, and they're going to pay off the debt. And here she comes to the prophet in desperation. You could be here this evening. It could be age issues. Abraham and Sarah are old. They're beyond childbearing years. Luke chapter 1, Zacharias and Elizabeth. Here they are, been trying for years to have kids. And again, they're past that point, man. They're along in years. So I want you to think about this. What limitation are you living under right now? What limitation has creation, has life created that you are living under? Is it health? Is it economic? Is it spiritual? Is it mental, emotional? Is it sickness? What is it this evening that you're living under that the reality is you wish you could get out from underneath this thing and live in victory over it? So let's talk about the God who can reverse nature. Because God created the world. He created nature. He created the universe. He has power over it. Let me say it another way. Creation is subject to God, not the other way around. Why could Henry Ford fix the car? He invented it. And it's the same thing with God. We are limited and we are subject to nature. We are subject to creation. The moment we're born, we begin to die. Ain't that a happy birthday wish? I mean, it's going to take effect. I remember years ago when I was in the service, and Sonny Wilkins will remember many a night driving out on the perimeter road out of Williams Air Force Base, and a very lonely assignment out there, basically going and just a whole lot of nothing really. But I remember there was times out there in the middle of the night. And I would see these farmers out there in their John Deere tractors in the middle. I mean, I'm talking at old dark 30 in the morning. They're out there. And here they'd be working. And so now and then, every so often, one of them would pull up next to the fence line. And I'd go out there. Maybe we'd talk for a moment. And you'd hear them say, "Looks like rain. Looks like rain. Got to get the harvest in. Got to get this in. It looks like rain." And so you'd see that they'd be out there, find out they've been out there 24, 36 hours. Because they are subject to the weather. Nothing they do is going to stop that rain. They've got to get the cotton in before it's destroyed. We are subject to gravity. I have discovered a new hobby. I have discovered a new passion. For my birthday back in September, they took me skydiving. And I have got to say, I am addicted. I am now trying to figure out what guns to sell to come up with money. I feel like an addict now. Like, okay, well, if I sell the Springfield Armory, and I'm trying to think, okay, how can I come up with more money to do this? Because there is nothing more exhilarating. There is something about grabbing onto that handlebar, and as they slide that door open, and the wind is rushing by, and all of a sudden you look and you go, wow!
Back in Tennessee, they got crows, man. This was a revelation to me.
I mean, you know, I've seen crows like on TV, you know, like in movies or something. But I've never seen these things like in real life. We have a church picnic. They show up. And I'm talking, you're like, I'm talking, guard the food, man. I mean, every so often you hear a mother, No, it's not that bad. But they are scavengers. They are thieves, ravens, crows. They don't bring you food. Yet God goes, I have commanded the ravens to bring food to you. John chapter 11, Lazarus. How many know when you're dead, you're pretty sick? I mean, I've been sick before. I've seen sick. But when you're dead, you're pretty sick. You know, I mean, to quote a famous movie, you know, you ain't mostly dead. You're completely dead, you know. And here, I mean, Jesus shows up on the scene, and he says, roll back the stone. I mean, that even the sisters, Lord, no. Lord, he's been dead 4 days. Listen, let me tell you about it, something you never forget. Once you smell a decomposing human body, there is like nothing. You smell him before you see him. You are on a crime scene. You're and all of a sudden you're just that putrefying sweet smell. I mean, we smell like nothing else when we're dead. And here's the lady, here's the sisters. No, don't, you don't want to open it. Roll back the stone. Lazarus! Come out here, boy. And he comes out, no stench, nothing. Because that's the God that we serve. Amen. So let's look at the key to overcoming limitations. I want to talk to you about calling on the name of the Lord. In life, creation has produced circumstances that you're living under. I live under circumstances that are beyond my control, let's say. The key then is to call on the name of the Lord that creation is subject to. Let me talk to you about prayer. Luke chapter 1, again, Zacharias and Elizabeth. They're unable to have children. He's ministering in the temple. The Bible says that the angel of the Lord appears to him. And what does he tell him? Zachariah, your prayers have been heard. Again, Jabez, the spirit of rejection is going to destroy him. But in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 9 and 10, it says that Jabez called upon the God of Israel. That's prayer. In our text, Hezekiah is lying on his deathbed. That even the prophet, now listen to me, this is the part that has always amazed me. That God reversed himself. That God sends the prophet, for thus says the Lord, you are not going to live. You're not going to survive this. You're going to die. Get the affairs of your home in order. He leaves. Hezekiah begins to weep. He begins to pray. He calls upon the name of the Lord, the Bible says. He says, Lord, I have walked loyally. I have been faithful to you. And the Bible says that the Lord, the voice of the Lord comes to Isaiah. He says, go back. Go back. He says, you tell him, I heard his prayers. I saw his tears. I'm adding 15 more years. You've got to grasp this, church. This man is on his deathbed. And he got God to reverse himself because of faith. Creation is subject to God. that he can reverse the effects of sickness. He can move on your behalf. Here's Ruth and Naomi. Talk about a situation, bad going, going from bad to worse. And here, they've all lost their husbands. In fact, Orpah went out and she's even turned back. She's lost all hope. And then here's Naomi, that even in her desperation, she's trying to send Ruth back home to just go home, go back to your people. I have nothing to offer you. I have nothing. I can't have any more kids. I have no money. I'm broke. I have no prospects. I have nothing. You have no hope with me. And here, we can only use our imaginations and try to imagine maybe the tears coming down Ruth's face as she's looking at her and she looks and she says, "Where you go, I will go. Your people shall be my people. Your God shall be my God. And where you die, I will die. And where they bury you, they'll bury me." And right there, God goes, "Oh, I love this girl." That here she's with limited resources. These two women have nothing. They don't have a nickel to their name. Yet this woman calls on the name of the Lord. She brings God, the Creator, into the situation. Your God shall be my God. And he gets involved. Oh, you're excited over Jesus. I'm undone. I never get tired of preaching on this young lady. That here she is. Could you imagine? I mean, and let's be honest. How many know Naomi was? Right? I mean, you know what I mean? She comes back to Bethlehem. Don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara. I mean, the treadmill's spinning, but the hamster died, man. She's losing it. You know, and then, so what? Here's Ruth, man. She's going to go out gleaning, back-breaking poor people's work. She's going to be out there gleaning, and she crosses into the field of Boaz. And I know I've probably preached on this before here. I never get tired of preaching this love story, you know. But here's Boaz. Could you imagine? He's standing there, and he's looking at her, and he's like, "Who is that?" Well, that's Ruth, the Moabite, Naomi's daughter-in-law. Yeah, by the way, Naomi's back in town. She's been gone here. She's back. And he's like, "Ruth, huh?" Probably, walks up here and goes, "Hey, what's your name?" Ruth. Mom says she bowed down at his feet. She says, "Ruth, what's your sign?" Pisces, me too. And next thing you know, here he is, this incredible visitation of grace on this young lady, where he says, where are you going? Where are you going tomorrow? Where? She says, "Well, I was maybe gonna go down to the field." No, stay here. Hang on, stay with my handmaids. And I've commanded the young men that they're not to harm me. Oh, you gotta lock that in, folks. She's a Moabite girl in Israel, if you know what I mean. Alone in a field, and he says, "I've commanded the men, they are not to harm you. And if you want to take a drink of water, you take a drink from their jugs." And then on top of that, the most beautiful part of the scripture, is that they're here the next day. Could you imagine they're getting ready to start and all the men are getting their assignments and their briefings. And here's Boaz tells the foreman, tell the men to drop handfuls on the girls. I mean, could you imagine? And the men are like, come again? drop handfuls on purpose for her. I mean, could you imagine these grown men? These are farmers, man. I don't know what I'm talking about. I mean, you know, they put the red in redneck, you know, these guys. You know? And they're out there. So could you imagine they're out there working, and then all of a sudden having to go, oh my, I have dropped wheat on accident. What a klutz am I? I can't bend down and get off of free. And then the guy next to him, and your klutziness has made me drop wheat too. On accident, completely on accident, I've dropped. And then through the field, I mean, could you imagine, guys? And here's Ruth at the end of the day, comes back to Naomi with God knows how much wheat. Going, Ruth, what in the world? Where did you get this? She goes, those guys are klutzes. But no, what was that? That's the God of creation. That's this young girl calls on the name of the Lord and brings the Creator down into her situation. He doesn't care about her background. He doesn't care about her mistakes. He doesn't care about her shortcomings. She tapped into something that God can help us, that God can minister and supernaturally intervene. And He intervenes in her economics. He intervened in her provision. He intervened in her protection, in her refreshing. And then not only that, God goes, oh, and I'm going to link her into the birth of my son, Jesus Christ. That's the God that we serve. That's your Heavenly Father. That's your Heavenly Father. You've got to grasp this, church. What circumstances are you living under right now? God goes, stop living in fear and torment. Call upon the God of creation. He says, and all come down. I invented creation. It works for me, and I can reverse it anytime I want. Amen. Let's give God praise this evening. Let's bow our heads. And I ask you to bow your heads with me. So appreciate your faithfulness this evening. So we get ready to dismiss tonight. I wonder, is there anybody here tonight that somebody's maybe invited you? You're in this place and maybe you've never heard a sermon like this before. Maybe you've never even been into a church like this. I walked into a congregation here in Chandler back in 1977. I'd never seen anything like this. I'd never encountered anything like this before. It was so foreign to me. But I heard the most simple message that I totally understood it. And I wonder if maybe you're here this evening, you're somebody's guest, or maybe you're here tonight, you're backslidden in your heart. Holy Spirit's drawing you into this place this evening. You can say, Pastor Alvarez, will you say a prayer for me tonight? I'm not right with Jesus. I'm living under the condemnation of sin. I'm living under the guilt and the shame of a life of sin. This evening, I need forgiveness. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. No one's looking around. If somebody lift your hand, I want to pray for you this evening. You know, I would consider it just a great honor to lead you in a sinner's prayer, introduce you to the Savior that saved me so many years ago. You're here tonight. You can say, Pastor Bob, will you pray for me? I want to rededicate my heart to Jesus. You lift up your hand where I can see it. You say, Pastor, I've never prayed. Maybe you're a church kid. You've been born and raised. I see your hand over here. God bless you. You're here. You're a church kid. You've been born and raised in church. You know what to do, how to do it, why to do it. But the reality is Jesus is not in your heart. You do what you do because you know that that's what you're supposed to do, but you're not saved. And tonight you want to surrender. Tonight you want to say, Pastor Alvarez, I want to give Jesus my heart. You lift your hand quickly. I want that one who lifted your hand. I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to step out of your seat. You lifted your hand. I want you to come. I want you to come right now. Amen. Let's all stand together in this place. I want to open up this altar. What limitations are you living under? What limitations, what atmosphere has creation created for you that you're living? Is it health? Is it financial? Is it mental? It could be social. People live. So many times they live under curse. And they don't even realize it. They're thinking it's just some type of socioeconomic pattern. In reality, you know, you're dealing with a spiritual curse. Is it years-long infirmity that you're dealing with right now? Call up Hezekiah, called upon the name of the Lord. He said, no. It doesn't end like this. It can't end like this. Lord, I've not been a heathen. I've not been a pagan. I've not been a rebel. I've served you the best I know how. Lord, not this. And God heard him and added 15 more years. Let me pray for you tonight. Father, I pray for every man and woman, God, in this congregation right now that are living under the circumstances, Lord, that life has created. Some, God, have been created by our own hands, and others, Lord, have been beyond our own control. Lord, I pray right now there's people here that need a miracle healing, God. The physicians have given their report, but Lord, you are the master physician. Father God, you are the God that heals us. There are people here tonight, Lord, that their desire is to have a child. I pray blessing of fruitfulness upon them. I pray, Lord, a financial blessing on those that have been living under hard, scrabble circumstances, Lord, hardship to hardship to hardship. Tonight, God, break the curse. Cause them to begin to start living above their circumstances, God. We call upon the God of creation, Lord, that can reverse life. Lord, we pray blessing, God. Lord, we take dominion over curse, God, and devour. This evening, we pray increase, blessing, dominion, fruitfulness, revelation, God, upon every man and woman in this congregation. Lord, I pray fruitfulness this year over this entire congregation, God. I don't care what the politicians say. I don't care what the circumstances say. You are the God of creation, Lord, and we claim that fruitfulness tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give him praise. Again, let me say from the bottom of my heart, once again, I so appreciate your prayers and your reaching out to my family and I during this time. Appreciate your faithfulness to the things of God. Remember 180 kids, teens, remember tomorrow, 3:30, the band leaves for Prescott, be on time. And are we having the guest, do we still have a guest band coming Saturday? We don't know. I don't know, but we're having 180, either way, 7:30, 180. Be faithful, be in your place. And then Sunday, my son preaches his farewell. Amen. So, good time for Jesus. Amen. Let's bow our heads this evening. And I'm going to ask Master Chief Bill Moorhead, close us in prayer.